Welcome to the Reboot Show. I'm Sally A. Illingworth, your host, and today I'm here with Luke Stow and Amy Smith, and we're excited to have a conversation about the impact that automation is likely to have on employment by 2025. So I'd love to hear from you, Luke, to start. What are you currently seeing in the market in terms of how organisations are using automation in the workplace?
Yeah, thanks, Sally. It's great to be here on the Reboot Show. And look, I think in simplest forms, you know, when you look at email marketing and getting your answers and inquiries automatically answered on a website, it might be a chatbot writing it, it might be a chatbot speaking to you over a phone system. They're probably the best examples of where corporations are using automation today.
Yeah, and I suppose on that note, like as organisations are starting to use automation more and more, starting with, for example, simpler tasks like customer inquiries and whatnot, but over time we're seeing that automation is becoming a more significant part of the workplace. So Amy, what would you say in terms of what does the empowered worker look like in the future given so many tasks are being automated?
Yeah, it's a great question. Thank you, Sally. Look, everyone kind of freaks out that robots are going to steal their jobs and that they're going to be out of work. But what we're seeing is a real change in the way that we work. And it means that new jobs are actually going to be created as well. Yeah. So what it means for the worker is they're actually going to be able to do more meaningful work. So all those little like tasks that you just can't be bothered with some days, it's great to have that taken off your plate through automation. And it means that you can get into the bigger stuff like problem solving and critical thinking and things that we actually really like to do at work.
And would you say, both of you, like in terms of putting those automated solutions in place, like how involved are the existing employees in actually making that a reality? Because in many cases, isn't it required that the employees have to help sort of transfer their IP over to a machine to an automated solution?
Yeah, look, I think that's a really great point. You know, from when I started out in the workforce, there was very little automation, and that doesn't tell you
are
how
you
old
showing
I am,
your
by
age
the way.
Here?
But basically, what we're looking at is, definitely. I think from a change point of view, it's critical that the workforce is engaged into that transition using more automation. And not just from a job point of view, but from a way of working. So I think that is really critical in adopting these type of solutions and services that people are involved right from the outset. Because it's not really about the technology, you know, when you really think about it, it's about the people. Yeah. And it's about the way they're going to work with that technology and service their customers and clients.
Yeah. And in terms of managing, I suppose, the ongoing quality, if you like, of ensuring that automation is working, like what sort of, whether or not either of you have seen organisations implement something, like what's that change management process look like? Because it's not just a matter of going, okay, we want to automate, for example, customer inquiries. So we're going to sit down, take the IP from an employee, get them to tell us what those usual frequently asked question answers are, and then we're going to build that out. There needs to be some sort of change management process to ensure that it's actually working to the benefit of the customer once it's implemented.
You know, it's really great you raised that because I think I'd like to hear from our subscribers about this because one of the main things I think that happens is that there is no change management. Usually what happens is people turn up to work, there's a new logo on their desktop and they click on it and they say, what the hell is this? The organization's really said nothing and someone in IT has just decided it'd be a great idea to roll that out. And so therefore the adoption of it really doesn't occur. It becomes a clumsy extra tool in the process that they've got to use to look after their clients or customers, and they're not really engaged. So this is really a critical point.
On that note, Amy, what can organisations be doing to ensure that they make their people a part of that adoption process so that the technology and the automation, for example, is actually given the opportunity to succeed?
Yeah, there needs to be that sense of ownership, right? Because, you know, like to Luke's point, you don't need just another tool, right, to learn and to add to all these other tools. It just adds complexity rather than actually trying to simplify the process, which was what it was kind of set out for in the beginning, right? Yeah. So you need to understand from the employee point of view, the people that are on the front line, the people that are actually doing the work, how is this going to fit in with what they're already doing to enhance what they're doing, to help them, to make it more efficient, more productive. And so they need to be a part of that process, and they need to be a part of it very early on.
And would you say that that then enables those employees to buy into that change? Because
absolutely.
I've certainly been aware of situations where organisations, they will just, to Luke's point, they'll just roll out this new tech, and then everyone's got this new logo. They have no idea what it means. And everyone goes, the technology isn't worth it. It doesn't work.
They blame
so
the
they
technology.
Don't buy in and they don't actually want it to work because they feel confused and intimidated by
and
technology.
You've had that experience yourself as a customer, right? You've called in somewhere and you can tell the person on the end of the phone, they just have no idea how to use the systems that are in front of them. They're trying to clumsily work their way through it, and it just becomes a nightmare of an experience as a customer.
So what does this mean for the customer? How can we make sure, like, what are the key things we need to be doing to make sure this is a success for the customer, and that, say, at a leadership level in organisations, we don't lose sight of the fact that this needs to build value for the customer, because in many cases, automation is cost efficient and it allows you to, for example, achieve economies of scale with certain processes. So what should leadership be doing to make sure that they have the customer experience at the forefront of every decision they make when it comes to automation?
Yeah, look, it's something I'm really quite passionate about. I think from a an organisational point of view, if you have customer front of mind, and you know that automation is about simplification, about efficiencies, then those things are really the same thing. You know, efficiencies are about how you look after your clients and customers. So organisations who've got that mindset, that cultural capability, I think you're going to do really well. And what it'll mean for their customers is simplicity. It'll mean they'll get their questions answered quickly. It'll mean that the organisation is really focused on helping them have a better experience. And for the workers in that organisation as well, let's not forget the empowered workforce here. The people who are dealing with the clients, they don't want to give the client a bad experience or the customer a bad experience. So giving them the tools.
And they're the user of the technology.
That's right. Because we've all had that experience, right, where you go to contact an organisation and they make you jump through all these different hoops, and then you're on this website and it'll say, go here and look up these FAQs and do all these sorts of things. And you're like, can I just pick up the phone and call someone? Like, sometimes even as a millennial, I think that, you know, like sometimes it's like you just want to make sure that you're doing what the customer needs, and you're solving their problems quite quickly. And so from the employer, employee's point of view, rather, you know, when you hear facts like, you know, 50% of jobs in the US are going to be automated by 2030, like,
does
there's
a
that
presidency?
Fear factor.
Can we get the president
well, look, I mean, that's a whole other conversation,
right,
Luke, but
another show, maybe.
another show. But,
you should be a technology consultant.
That puts a fear factor in the employee. So you don't want that translating through to the customers either. So you actually need everyone to be a part of that process.
And I think that's a great point. And you touched on it a little bit earlier, Luke, around sort of efficiencies, but also experience. And I think there's a challenge at a leadership level for some reason. When leaders think about achieving cost efficiencies, they think that that means you can't still have a great customer experience. So they get so focused on the cost management, cost minimization, and they forget about how that experience is actually evolving over time when they're achieving those cost efficiencies.
Yeah, look, I think that's you've really hit the nail on the head there in terms of the challenge, and I think it's a mental model thing. I have been conditioned to look for efficiencies and cost cutting, and you know, you're either looking for growth as an organisation, or you're into cost cutting, or into product development. You know, what about all of them together? How does this all work from a client and customer point of view? So that mental conditioning has really had a profound impact on corporate and small business as well.
Yeah.
You know, and I think what this means is that it's really challenging for people to understand, well, how do I bring this together to make a better experience for our customers? But it's changing. Let's just face this. The customer and clients are starting to be at the center of control. And in fact, I think it's been that way for a little while now. And I'm interested to see, you know, post-COVID.
Do you think that's because of an awareness piece and customers are more aware, and therefore they have higher expectations because they know what's possible?
Yeah, absolutely.
And they have access to information as well. So they're just more empowered to have a bit more of a self-service model to begin with. They've got the technology and that capability to do that. And we're always on.
So would you say that the modern consumer wants more self-service? They want to have more control, say, over that checkout experience or that inquiry.
I think they expect it now.
Do you know, there was a sharp increase in the like and the credibility of banks within Australia as they started to close branches and moved online banking.
You're saying, sorry, that the perception of their credibility was increasing as they started to
close? Yeah, well, people started to like the brand more. Mm. The brands became more favourable as they started to close down their face-to-face branches and move to online. Great example.
Yeah.
Consumers don't want to go into a bank. I mean, last time I was in a bank, I was very frustrated. I had to wait. There's only two people serving there. It sort of smells, you know, it's sort of like that.
It's very traditional, right?
Yeah,
and that's one of those spaces that probably has been deprived of innovation for the customer.
Yeah. Well, they could do something about the lines and make those, just putting more people on would probably help you get through quicker, but you know, yeah.
So in terms of, say, you know, standard or common business processes and whatnot, whether it's customer facing or it's internal management, what would you, like, what are your thoughts on maybe where we can expect to see automation become a bigger thing? Like, what process is it? What part of the business is it? What function is it in? Is it mostly, for example, customer facing for the time being? Or do you think that the biggest focus at the moment and where the most amount of growth for automation, is it internal or is it external with the customer?
Yeah, look, I think it's a great question. I think, look, both. Don't mean to sit on the fence there, but I think that technologies are really rapidly advancing. And, you know, if you just look at platforms like Salesforce, for example, the amount of money that they're spending on innovation and automation in their process is, you know, phenomenal. And through that type of investment, what we'll see is people using those platforms will be able to leverage the automation within those tools rather than go and build their own. So what I'm expecting to see is that investment will continue, and we'll continue to see both back-end and front-end processes changing.
So particularly when it comes to people management, sorry Luke, in organisations, what are some things, Amy, that leaders should be thinking about when it comes to, okay, we want to use these automated solutions. What should they be thinking about in terms of how they maybe retrain to retain their existing employees that will be made effectively redundant if a lot of their tasks are automated?
Yeah, I think you said the key word there is retrain, right? There needs to be an element of being able to upskill your workforce. And that doesn't mean doing, you know, year-long degrees or anything like that. It's that just-in-time learning that's going to be really fundamental moving forward, because things are changing at such a rapid pace. Sometimes it feels really hard for organisations.
And overwhelming as well.
So, you know, you need to have a continual element in your business that allows people to upskill into this digital landscape. And that's a continual process, you know, whether or not you go through this big change process and then you're like, okay, here's our new system, off you go. It needs to be a continual process beyond once it's been implemented as well.
Yeah, it's a really interesting term, like reskill. I personally don't like it. I think what we're talking about
now is
more...
Well, we use the word retrain for the record, but continue.
Or retrain, thank you, Sally. Correcting me. But I think like right train or right skill is probably more appropriate. Look, we've got to get used to the fact we're always going to be learning new skills.
Yeah.
And I think for what does automation mean for the workforce? I think that means just continuous training, continuous improvement.
Yeah.
I think process will become much more a part of it. Data will become much more a part of it.
Yeah.
You know, I personally think process is more important, but you know, let's not get into that debate.
Won't,
I know how
we
much
won't
you love data. But basically,
thank God Switzerland's
I think I think that that's probably an area where organisations will even start to automate and put online some of the training capabilities as well. I mean, we're seeing this happen enormously for learning, and you know, organisations I think will start to develop their own set of libraries about how to train people, plus they'll leverage off others.
And I think now with COVID, right, people have had no choice with organisations. If they were resisting being in the online space before COVID hit, like they're not anymore, they don't have a choice. So they need to be able to have a way that they can train their staff, they can operate online, whether or not that continues at that, you know, big level that it has been over the last few months, or we create a bit more of a hybrid model. But that is an element that moving forward, organisations, even small businesses, just can't avoid.
And you know what else? People are running their own right skilling. You know, what I'm saying is the evolution of, you know, people just owning their own learning. And, you know, I don't have to wait for more organisation.
Well, to Amy's point earlier, our capability to access information at scale and the diversity of that information, there's no longer all this red tape about what, you know, information or insight you can gain access to, and therefore everyone has the capability to continuously upskill themselves at a rate faster than any organisation would probably offer it.
Yeah, that's right.
And it's having that sense of ownership and empowerment to be able to do that as well. Like, it's not completely up to the organisations. It's a two-way street.
And I think the key message for our viewers is really, if you're looking at skilling yourself for this era of automation, you know, look at getting yourself into some training, right? Skill yourself for things like, you know, data, process automation, how automation is going to work within organisations, user experience.
Would you say there's any particular roles or skill sets that we're going to see an increase in demand for amid this move towards automation becoming something more commonplace? For example, is there a new sort of professional title that's likely to potentially come out, automation trainer or something to that effect?
Yeah, you're right. Like there are, you know, people in primary school right now, 65% of those kids are going to be operating in jobs that don't yet exist.
Yeah, wow. Right?
So there's going to be an abundance of new roles created and all of those things are kind of unknowns at this moment.
Yeah.
That's right. But that's all the unknowns, right? But the thing is, like, you know, 10 years ago, we've got drone managers now that we didn't have 10 years ago. People can be chief listening officers.
Yeah.
Like there's like, if you want to go for some crazy job titles, they're out there, you can find them.
So on that note, would you say that, Amy, there is potentially value, even though it may not be the people in preschool at the moment, but leaders in well-established businesses that probably, you know, they're established and in that sense, they've got legacy issues. Some of those legacy issues may be good, some may be bad. Would you say that it's probably critical for them to consider how they bring on, you know, diversity in their thinking through millennial leaders to help them as they try and transition to understand what the future looks like for their business?
Yeah, I think it is that hybrid model, right? It's about bridging that generation gap, and it doesn't really matter whether you're a millennial or a boomer or whatever.
Thanks
it's
for saying that.
It's being, yeah, like I'm being inclusive.
You're still important, Luke.
You're still important.
Right.
It's still important. It really doesn't matter about age. It's about your mindset, and it's about really being able to adapt, be open-minded, have that growth mindset to learning. That's what's going to get you through this.
Yeah, and I think when you think about workforce and people who've been out of the industry or an industry for a while, but they're looking at re-entering, we should be encouraging that in Australia. We should be encouraging people to go out and get right skilled for the workforce. And I think that should be open and inclusive to all ages and all genders and, you know, preferences, etc. I think we need to make that a very inclusive process.
Yeah.
And
because it is quite overwhelming, particularly if you have left the workforce and you're looking to re-enter, you sort of maybe in some instances respectfully feel like a bit of a dinosaur with how
like
quickly things have changed.
Yeah.
And so if you don't feel included in that process, well, then you're not really encouraged to rejoin the workforce.
No, that's right. And look, when we just talk about automation, I'm just looking for the time when my wine fridge can be refilled automatically and I don't even have to go out, you know, to buy anything. When that happens, I'll be really satisfied.
Yeah. This is a professional technology show.
Oh,
this is not Diaries of Luke Stow.
Yeah, thanks, Sally. Thank
So what are the key takeaways for today for the audience?
Look, I think that the key takeaway from my point of view is don't be afraid of automation and what that may do to the workforce or what it may do to your experience. I think we're in for some positive experiences both as a consumer and as a client and also in the workforce. I think what we're seeing, the latest statistics are that, I think there's a great growth in terms of job opportunities that comes with automation as well. So, yeah.
Yeah, I'd say don't buy into the doom and gloom because there's plenty of positive opportunities out there. You just need to have that mindset where you're willing to adapt, you're willing to learn. It's that continual learning aspect that I think is really important moving forward.
Yeah. Well, I think that's great. And I know here at the Reboot Show, we're very passionate about engagement. So would you both say that automation is something that can help in some cases, not just with our show, but help people to improve the engagement between their stakeholders?
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah.
I think it's fundamental and it's part now of the experience that you need to offer as an organisation or an entity.
Yeah.
I think if you don't, you know, you risk, obsolescence in this new future.
Yeah, you will be left behind. That's
You'll
the bottom line.
You'll be out of a job and we don't want that.
We don't want that.
Thank you so much for joining me on the Reboot Show today, Amy.
You're
and
welcome.
Luke Stow. Thank you to everyone for tuning in. Please do make sure that you subscribe to our YouTube channel and we will see you for our next segment.
Bye.
Bye.